Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I'm back from the break, and I hope you all had good lunch. Hi, Grace. So next talk is by Grace, and the topic is building plugins using Pluggee. So Grace, stage is yours.
Thank you. Before getting started, is my screen visible and my voice audible?
Yeah, I can
Good
hear you.
evening. Welcome to my talk. Good evening. Welcome to my talk, Build Plugins with Pluggee. Who am I? I'm Grace Kumar from Bangalore. I'm a software engineer and I like reading fiction and poetry. How is this talk structured? The talk is structured into three parts. In the first part, we will show you code which is developed using a normal style without plugins. In second part, I will discuss about what is a plugin system, what is Pluggee. In third part, I will discuss the same code application which is developed using Pluggee, and we will discuss why it's writing code using Pluggee or plugin architecture is better suited for certain use cases. Here is an example code. For the course of this talk, I will use a simple example application where the application collects the user input from the command line and makes a HTTP request to a service called Gutenberg and prints the output. It is a command line application to illustrate the need for a plugin system and when you should use such kind of a concept. Let's get into the code. The application class is responsible for a workflow of the code. The run method is orchestrates the entire workflow. The first is gets the use input from the user. Second, the term which user entered is processed using the processor. Second, and sorry, third is like you search the particular term in the internet to find whether the book or the author is available. Third, depending on the output choice of the user, you format the output using the render output function. As of now, the render output function can output the output in two particular formats. One is JSON format, other in a tabular format. So in a normal architecture, how does the code look? You have a core functionality and other functionality are built on top of it. In our case, the core functionality is getting the user input and searching for the respective results is the core functionality. Other functionalities include like rendering the output, exporting the results in a certain format. What are some shortcomings of this particular way of writing code? Let's go back to the code once and then come back to the slide. As you can see, the code, the entire render output function is something which is hard to extend. For example, here we only support only two formats. Tomorrow, if the programmer or the developer needs to support multiple formats, say XML, HTML, and other formats, it becomes hard for the maintainer to keep adding the code. And next is it's hard to extend the program for all the user requests, then maintainability becomes harder. And the final disadvantage is the code is not extensible. For an example, there can be a new format like YAML format, or it can be a very specific format which is related to the Microsoft or Windows or any kind of an operating system. And then it requires the developers to know the ins and outs of that particular format to support it. So without having a plugin kind of an architecture, it is hard to maintain the code base and becomes non-extensible. Let's get into like what is plugin system. So what is a plugin? A plugin is a software component which adds a specific feature to an existing computer program at a runtime. And the concept of plugin is not new. It has been in the software industry for a very long time. For an example, all major web browsers support plugins. It can be Google Chrome plugins or Firefox add-ons. For example, in Firefox, if the output is in JSON format, the Firefox automatically renders in nicely formatted with indentation and everything. But it, at the same time, if the output or the response from the server is in a HTML format, it knows how to render the output. As you can see, you must have used any of the plugins already to say, on hovering over an image, it should enlarge it, or you want to zoom in the images. So the plugin concept is not new to the world, but it has its own advantages and disadvantages. And if you see Linux has been using kernel drivers, which almost uses plugin kind of a concept. And while developing a custom software, there are use cases where plugin-based architecture really helps developers to maintain the code and extend the functionality of the code. Here is how a plugin architecture looks. As you can see, there are two different colored components, one in blue color, other in orange color. So the one in the blue color is the core system or a host program. The host program is the driver of the program. At particular runtime, whenever there's a plugin register to do some kind of a functionality, the core system calls the plugin to render a functionality or to act on the particular data. In a plugin architecture, there are two important components. One is core program or a core system or a host program, and second is the plugin or a hook. So now let's come to the particular library which we will discuss throughout the talk. The library is called Pluggy. Pluggy is a Python library which provides a structured way to manage and discover plugins and enable hooks to change the behavior of the host program at runtime. Pluggy is like any other Python library. You can add it as a dependency and start writing your code with few modifications. It helps you to develop your applications as a plugin-based architecture. How Pluggy works. Before getting into how Pluggy works, let's look into a visual representation how a plugin actually works. As we have already seen, the plugin architecture has two important components. One is a host program and second is the plugin. In this gray box represents the host program, and all the other blocks represent the logical functionality of a program rather than the exact flow. The arrows represents the flow of the execution, and with only with limited understanding of the code. So the program starts, and first step in a plugin-based architecture is you call some kind of a plugin manager. So plugin manager responsibility is to discover the plugins. In this case, we have two plugins, output and header. So it discovers two plugins, output and header, and then it registers the plugin. It does some kind of a bookkeeping. And once at runtime, the host program decides to call that particular registered plugins, those hooks gets called. When the hook gets the data, now it's up to the hook to receive the data, and it can act on the data and return the data. Return data is optional, not mandatory, but receiving the data is mandatory, and transforming the data, depending on the conditions and the configuration, it changes. Once the hook has completed its functionality, the execution comes back to the host program and some sort of a cleanup happens, and then the program exits. I'll take a sip of water. As you can see, this gray box represents a single process. The biggest disadvantage or advantage of a plugin-based architecture is everything runs in a single process space. Even the plugins are different code base, they act in a single process namespace, and everything works like yet another library call. So here's a sample code of a plugin. First thing is the host.py is the host program. So in this case, the host program is responsible for getting user input and making HTTP request and rendering the output. The hook specification specifies the contract of the hook or plugin. And the actual implementation of the hook lies in this program, output.py. So this is a high level representation of the directory structure. Next is the terminology. There are multiple terminologies associated with Pluggy and plugin-based architecture. Let's see one by one. The first important concept is a core system or a host program, where the program enters. And the second is the implementation of a plugin. For example, in this case, we will be implementing a render or print output in for different formats. Each format will have one particular functionality to implement. That is, if it's a JSON, it will print the output in JSON format. If it is in YAML, it will print the output in the YAML format. So the plugin manager is the coordinator plugin manager is responsible for finding the plugins and registering the plugins, and then giving access to the all the registered plugins to the host program. Next is hook specification. So hook specification is a blueprint or a contract where the plugin manager understand what is a hook name and what should be the signature of the function or a method. In plugin, all the specification is specified as a Python code, that is like a Python function or a method. Now, hook implementation is where the actual implementation of the hook happens. Here is a high-level overview of the host.py file with all the code being removed and replaced by the comments. The setup sets up the plugin manager and passes on the command line arguments which are passed during the execution of the program to the registered plugins. And then the CLI is responsible for getting the user input. For developing this application, we are using a Qlik Python library. Once the user enters a term, the user input is validated, then the search workflow kicks in. And the search class is responsible for taking care of that. The run function is the one which coordinates the entire workflow. First is to make the request, then is to check the response and pass on the output to the registered plugin. Let's get into some of the details. Hook specification. Hook specification is nothing but a contract of the hook. The first step in developing a hook specification is creating a hook specification marker with a project name. The project name is how the both hook specification and hook implementation are tied together by the plugin manager. So first you create an instance of a hook spec, and then you mark the Python function or a method with as a hook spec as a decorator. And here the contract is the function arguments. This function takes two arguments, response and a config. And as you have seen, this body is empty. For hook specification, the body should be empty. Actual implementation goes into the hook implementation part. And the name of the hook is going to be the name of this particular function. The hook specification and the implementation should follow the same name and the same function name and the same function arguments. Next is hook implementation. The first step in creating a hook implementation is creating an implementation marker with the same project name. And you use the created instance to mark the function as an implementation. The plugin knows that print output, there's a respective specification mentioned with hook implementation marker. It knows this specification has to be matched with this implementation. The function signature is same. And it can take extra arguments, but it is not compulsory, but minimum number of arguments is required. And let's dive into the function body. What is the actual implementation? So this particular hook implementation outputs the response in a JSON format. So first it extracts the JSON data from the response and formats it and gets some sort of information from the response like name and what is the title and download count. And then it goes about getting the configuration details for the output. For example, there's if condition which says if the format is JSON, then it prints the JSON in a colored format if the colored specification is passed. And if, for example, if the format is something else, say YAML, then what happens is this particular implementation will not do anything. It will not print any result. It will just move on. So third is a plugin manager. So plugin manager takes care of the responsibility of registering the plugin and all the plugin creating an instance for the hooks to be called later. So plugin manager, how do we create a plugin manager? First, you create instance of plugin manager with the same project name. And then we add the hook specification. So by now that plugin knows that for this particular project name, these are the hook specification. And then you register a hook implementation. In our case, output.py file lies in the same repository. But sometimes what happens is like developer may create these hooks and third-party developers may create hook implementations. So in that case, what we do is we can load using a setup tools entry point. That is any Python package which has been published as a setup.py packaging method can be used during the execution of the flow. The important part is that setup tools entry point should also be same name for both plugin manager and the registered setup tool entry point. Both should share the same name. Once that is done, then we have a plugin manager. So final is the invocation of the hook. So this is the same code what we saw earlier, but with actual code, no comments. First, user gets the input, and then the plugin manager is instantiated. Then the search runs through, and the run method, which is responsible for coordinating the flow. So the important point to note is once we have a plugin manager, the plugin manager has an attribute called hook. So we pass the attribute pm.hook to the search class, which hook. So this particular attribute hook contains all the entries for the hooks which are registered to the plugin manager. As you can see, the name of the hook which we are calling is print output, which is same as the specification and the implementation. And when we call self.hook.printOutput, the program flow goes into the plugin, developed plugin, and then the code returns back. Let's see the example output of such a code. Here is an output from a program what we just saw. In first case, the search term is my freedom and my bondage with a configuration indent as to. In the second execution, we use same title but with a different indent. So indent is 214, and the output is indented using the indent size as 214. You can see the difference in the printing. And since by default color is equal to 2, the output is rendered in different colors. Let's look into some of the internals of this plugin. As you have already seen, that it is quite possible to have more than one particular plugin. So for example, we only implement a JSON printing. Let's say if we implement a YAML printing, now what will happen? There will be a two implementation for a single specification. So it is technically possible to have one specification and many number of implementation. In that case, what happens is plugin calls each one of the registered plugins in last in first out order. Let's say if we have three registered plugins, one for XML, one for JSON, one for YAML, it calls them in last in first out order, and each of the registered hook gets the same data and it gets passed on, and it can act depending on the configuration. So it is up to the developer of the plugins to figure out when to act, when not to act. So for example, if the configuration is passed in as a YAML, it is up to the JSON plugin not to modify the data or not to change any of the data. That is up to the developers. As we have seen, there can be more than one plugin for one specification. So in that case, sometimes it may be important to short circuit the system. For example, if there are 20 registered plugins, we may want to short circuit as soon as there is an output from the one of the respective designated plugin. Let's say we have a YAML plugin, JSON plugin, and XML plugin. As soon as a YAML plugin completes, we want to not call next two registered plugins. In that case, what we can do is the configuration, that is the hook specification, while decorating the particular function, we can specify first result is equal to true. In that case, what happens is when the first plugin returns the result to the host program will not call the rest of the plugins. That is, plugin will short circuit and it will pass the collector result as a result, and the program execution moves on. So this helps in saving a lot of execution time and improves the performance. And as you already know, the result is a list of results from each plugin. It is not a single return value, it is a list of return values. So testing the plugin. How do you test the plugin? The first thing is you create a unit test. So first thing to remember is like testing plugins in Python for Pluggy is simple. For example, here is a print output. So we are passing some output to the output from the request to the print output function, and we are testing it like any other function. Of course, this you may have some kind of aversion that this is not actually a unit test because we are making HTTP request. That's correct. We can use a dummy response or a fake response. That should not matter. But testing any plugin function or plugin method is same as testing any other Python code. So next is the integration tests. How do we do an integration test? As you remember from the earlier size, the application is a command line application. So to have an integration test, you need to have the host program and the plugin come together. And first thing in this is to set up. And we are using Qlik as a command line application. So Qlik gives a nice CLI runner to run integration test. So we create a runner instance, and then we invoke the respective registered function. And then we pass the arguments. The important thing to note is the colorize is made false because checking the colors in the render terminal is a bit difficult, but we are only going to test the indent size it is true. That's why the expected output is indented accordingly. And you get the result and you strip the output and check both the return result and the expected outputs are same. Again, in doing integration test is simple and how we do for any other command line application. Some of the examples of real world projects. The Pluggy was created as a plugin system for PyTest library. So PyTest is a Python test runner which helps in writing Python test easier. For example, if you have used coverage plugin helps you to find out what code has been tested, what code is not tested. So which is something most people tend to use. And PyTest coverage is implemented using Pluggy. You can go see the source code. And it is and PyTest ecosystem has more than hundreds of plugins. And the next is a Tox. So Tox is another system which uses Pluggy. So Tox's intention is standardize the Python testing with multiple Python versions and make the testing easier. And the final project is Dataset. So Dataset helps you to publish your dataset and make the users to explore the dataset. For example, if your dataset in CSV format, but you wanted to publish the dataset in a SQL format, and then you have some interactive system where users can explore, that is exactly where Dataset comes into play. It helps you to do that. And some useful links, the code which I have shared for the entire talk is available in my GitHub repository. you can go to krayskumar/pluggytalk and access the code. And in case you have any questions regarding the talk, please feel me to reach out during the talk or after the talk in Twitter, if you are on Twitter. And finally, stay safe and wear mask. Thank you.